What's up, Internet? Time for another fun installment of Hobby Citizen Science, which basically means that we're trying to do our best to be scientific. And today we're going to talk about quite a confusing and misunderstood topic, albino or albinism versus the all-white leucistic snake. So we have Griff, our albino, here, and we have over here our ivory ball python. And I know when most people think of leucistic, they think of the blue-eyed leucies, but there's more than one kind of leucism, including black-eyed leucistics, and we're going to talk a little bit more in detail about that today. But first, we're going to start with the albino. When we talk about albino, basically what we're referring to is the lack of pigmentation, specifically when we talk about melanin. Melanin is a protein that acts as a gene that darkens. So the more melanin in the pigmentation, the more melanin in the skin, the darker the animal. Albinism means that there's no melanin whatsoever. So that's how you would get the white snake. But not all protein that causes pigmentation is just melanin. That's how you get this yellow here. So the melanin that's in snakes most of the time is, so you know, when you look at a normal ball python, the white is usually brown, or is the white is usually black, and then the brown is this yellow color. So because there's no melanin, the black that's the normal striping on here, or the normal pattern, turns white. But because there's other pigments in the animal, that's how you get the yellow of that. And also because there's no pigmentation and there's no melanin, when you look at their eyes, I know I'm just gonna keep spinning you and I'm really sorry. When you look at their eyes, they don't have any pigmentation in their eyes. And so when you look through their eyes, what that pink color is actually you seeing straight through when you're seeing all the blood vessels, and that's why it appears pink. And so that's what we talk about when we talk about albino, is just a complete lack of melanin in their pigment. And leucistic. So, leucistic, those are those white animals, usually with blue eyes, but an ivory ball python is a type of leucism. So, when we think about leucistic, it's going to get a little complicated, so bear with me here, guys. You are just so squirmy today. Leucism is basically a phenotype, so the pattern of that, of the animal, that is a, which causes a defect in pigment migration of the snake, which causes some or all of the cells to fail to develop. So what that means is that, so when we say that the phenotype, the outward pattern of the snake, then we talk about the cell or pigment migration. What that means is that what we have is, and cats are making a mess over there. So when the animal is developing in the egg, what starts to develop is the pattern, and the cells of that which contain pigment start to develop in that. The leucistic phenotype or the leucistic gene causes that migration or the development of the pigment cells to get kind of wonky and messed up. So that causes some of them to stop developing, which leads to the white pattern or the light pigment of the snake. Sometimes not all of the big pigmentation fails, and that's how you get some animals that aren't completely white. So with this ivory, you can't really see it in this light, but it has this really, really faint yellow, almost purplish hue just running right down the top of a little stripe, as well as right here on the head. You can see there's a little bit of pigmentation right there. You know, with super fires, which is another black-eyed leucistic, sometimes you get those kind of like orangey yellow spots that pop up. And what that means is that some of the cells did start to develop a little bit, even with that leucistic gene. And what that is actually referring to is kind of a hypo, which means a reduction of, or hypopigmentation or hypomelanism. So it still has melanin, but it's reduced, and there can be partials and complete. So the blue-eyed leucistics, which are all white, are completely hypomelanized, which means that there's no pigment whatsoever. But other animals, so like for instance, and I know some people are going to yell at me a little bit, but this is actually true, the piebald ball python, that is actually technically a partial leucistic animal, where some of the genes, some of the cells, failed to develop, which leads to the white, and some did, which leads to the more normal, kind of funky colored, but black and brown patterning of the piebald snake. The other fun thing about leucism is that it can also have to do with kind of like how the cells and traffic go to the eyes and develop the eyes. So with the blue-eyed leucistic, what we were kind of talking about before is it has to do with eye development of some animals. And that is what causes the pigment of the eye to not develop properly, and that's what leads to the blue color. But that can also end up resulting in some less than wanted developments, like the bug eyes, where their eyes don't develop properly, but what that happens is sometimes their eyes can get really big. And that can happen in ball pythons, as well as it happens in like the blue-eyed leucistic Texas rat snakes and in palmetto corn snakes, which in a corn snake is kind of this white snake with kind of like a confetti or firework pattern of this red pigment with blue eyes, but that can still sometimes have like these pop-eyed, bug-eyed things. And what that means is when it basically, you know, a lot of times people thought that they could kind of like line breed that out and not breed those bug-eyed animals and only breed the ones that had normal functioning eyes. But more than likely, there is something about the gene which makes the white snake, which causes this white pattern and the blue eyes to occur, also can lead to this bug-eyed thing. But so basically, that's what the difference is between albino and leucistic. And I know that was really complicated and may have been hard to follow, but basically, the albino, which I don't have up here, but that's okay, the albino has no melanin whatsoever. It's a lack of melanin pigment. But there are other cells that do develop, which don't necessarily contain melanin, but still contribute to pigment. And that's how you get the yellow snake. With leucism, it's some or all of the cells failing to develop, period, which leads to this all-white snake, which also has to do with the way the eye develops, so you get that blue-eyed color sometimes. But they don't always completely fail to develop. That's how you get the splotches of pattern on fires. Like on the Super Mojaves, you sometimes get this kind of like brownish-gray head stamp, black-eyed leucistics, and partially white animals like piebalds and palmetto corn snakes. But I hope that was... Okay. Hopefully you guys got something from this. I know when it comes to genetics and stuff like that, it gets a little complex. That's actually one of the reasons why I love ball pythons so much. I mean, I like all snakes in general, but ball pythons make it pretty easy because there's so much research and development and breeding and all these things that have led to and discovered about all these crazy genetic things, which I just love so much. And so when I really love something, I end up just kind of talking and ranting about it, and I can get pretty long-winded about these things. So hopefully you guys were able to follow along with that, and so hopefully that can kind of help give the guys a distinction about the difference between albino and leucistic. If you guys enjoyed this, please like and subscribe. I would really appreciate it. Really, really help me out. I want to get this thing across to a lot of people. You know, there's a lot of division in this hobby about some people do things wrong, some people do things wrong. We need to come together, and that's why I'm trying to do these videos, where hopefully this kind of base information helps everybody get on the same ground footing and on this, and everyone kind of have the same base knowledge and understanding that we can move forward together as a whole community. And so that goes for all the husbandry and all the individual species, down to stuff like this, to just understanding the individual snakes and species and morphs and genetics, which is why it's so cool and why it's so amazing that we get to keep these snakes in this hobby. You know, if you have any ideas, any comments, want to help me out, please let me know down in the comments. Once again, like and subscribe. And I hope you guys have a good day. I'll catch you next time.